morning and welcome. For those of you who don't know me, you're the lucky ones. My name's Simon and I lead the team here at New Life Church. It's great to welcome you to New Life Online. One of the things I love about this is that you may be a regular attendee of New Life, or this could be the first time you're catching us online. You could be in my street, or you could be the other side of the world. My in-laws who live on the South Coast are able to attend church with us here in Biggin Hill this morning. And then this afternoon, they'll pop in into their son's church in Florida, all from the comfort of their own home. It's also great to welcome friends from across the world who are either joining us live this morning or watching on catch up on our YouTube channel. You see, as a local church, we're part of a global family called Regions Beyond, all of whom are being impacted and affected by COVID-19. For some, it's an inconvenience, and for others, it's proving to be devastating. Just this week, one of our churches in India, One Nation Church, a church which is dear to my family's heart, lost one of their worship leaders to this virus. He lived with his family in a small home in one of the most densely populated slums in Asia. 13 members of his family live with him and now are starting to be symptomatic. Across this nation and the nations, lives are being lost and families are being torn apart. For some of us, it feels like a distant threat, and we even run the risk of becoming a little complacent. For others, the reality of this threat is all too real. We want to share with you a short message from Steve Oliver, who leads our family of churches.
Well, good day to all of you who are watching this live stream across the nations. We as a movement of churches are located on 6 continents and we deal with many different situations. Together as a family of churches, we are gathering resources to be able to help those in deep need. We have people suffering in many, many different ways, many not even knowing where tonight's meal will come from. If you'd like to join us and you'd like to give into our global C19 Response Fund, please watch for the details that will come now and join us. We will make sure that we bring relief to many who are suffering across the nations. This is not limited to poor nations, but right across the world, in the most developed cities and nations, we are seeing extreme hardship. This is a time that we can play our part, and we are doing our best. God bless you. Thank you for your generosity and for standing with us.
Let's pray together. Father, sometimes we struggle to find the words to pray when the situations and circumstances around us seem so overwhelming. The mountains seem too intimidating. We wonder whether our prayers will have any impact. And yet, Lord, we cry out to you for friends and family, near and far, for this entire planet right now. Lord, we pray, will you heal our land? Father, please comfort those who mourn. Lord, heal those who are sick. Bring peace to those in fear. Lord, give wisdom across the nations to those in power. Lord, give strength to those who are caring for the sick and the vulnerable. And let your gospel, the good news, drown out the bad news we're subjected to. Jesus, build your church. Lord, we commit this offering to you and asking that you bless it and use it across the world. Amen. Amen. So we're going to look together at part of Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, a letter we know as Ephesians. And I'm going to pick up on another part of what Gareth's been calling the PPE of God, or the armour of God. If you take a bit of a bird's eye view of this letter to the Ephesians, there are 3 actions that Paul encourages the church with. The first 3 chapters are an encouragement to sit, to give thanks, to seek God and rest in his gospel. He reminds them of this wonderful gospel, which he calls people to sit and rest in God, to accept our new identities in him and to pray. The gospel's not about what you do. It's about sitting under what God has done. You can't earn God's love or earn your salvation. You can't buy your way into God's kingdom. You must sit in recognition that there's nothing that you can do to save yourself. Your only hope is Jesus. And the gospel, among other things, is the good news that through Jesus, through his life, his death and his resurrection, he's made a way for us all who put our faith in him. That we can sit in the knowledge that he has done it. that he's purchased for us this new life. And in the first three chapters of this letter, Paul reminds the church in Ephesus that it's finished, that they can sit. He then goes on to encourage them to walk. He says, look, you've sat under this truth and the liberation and transformation of the gospel. Now walk in the good of it. Walk in unity with one another. Let your lives and actions be shaped by what God has done and is doing by his Spirit in you. Put on the new self. Walk in love. Model the kingdom of God as you do life. Let that shape how you walk in your relationships, the most intimate ones and the ones that we may struggle with. What wonderful encouragement. And then, finally, he teaches them to stand. So he teaches them to sit, to walk, and then to stand. Not sit, walk, and advance, or sit, walk, and take ground. But as we'll see in a moment when I read the passage to us, his encouragement is to stand in the good of the gospel that he describes in the first three chapters. To stand in the armour of God. Armour which is only a temporary outfit for us too. William Gurnall, who was an Anglican minister in the 16th century, is known for his writings called The Christian in Complete Armour. And he writes, in heaven we shall not appear in armour, but in robes of glory. But it is here today that we must wear it day and night. We must walk, work, and sleep in it, or else we're not true soldiers of Christ. So on that note, let's read together Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armour of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armour of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in the opening of my mouth, boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. So when Paul says that he's an ambassador in chains, He wasn't being metaphorical. He was literally in chains because he was in prison in Rome. I wonder if, as he pondered his captivation, as he observed the soldiers standing guard of his cell, that maybe God spoke to him. In spite of his circumstances, he gets this wonderful little insight into what being prepared for battle in Christian life may look like. And there's an encouragement for us straight away, isn't there? That we may feel captive at the moment, but that doesn't mean that God won't speak to you or even use your captivity to be a blessing to others, just like he did with Paul. Now, Gareth already touched on the belt of truth and the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness and the shield of faith, which leaves us with the sword and the shoes. Now, arguably, they're the two more offensive pieces of armour. The belt, helmet, breastplate and shield are all important, but they're primarily used as a defence. Even the sword is a multi-purpose part of armour. Both can be used in defence and offence, but only the shoes are exclusively used for attack. Now, it is slightly ironic that I'm speaking about shoes this morning, when any of you who know me well will know that I'm often barefooted. I once went two whole weeks without putting on shoes, and that included going shopping, eating out, and generally doing life, all without footwear. However, we all know just how important shoes are. What's the one thing that can often cause families to be delayed in leaving the house, finding and putting on shoes? No outfit is complete without shoes, and it obviously matters what activity you're planning to do as to which shoes are most suitable to wear. No one's going to leave base camp at the foot of Everest with the best coat money can buy, the top of the range trousers, all the best kit that you can possibly get, and then be wearing Crocs. One could argue that there's never an acceptable time to wear Crocs. And yes, I'm talking to you, my father-in-law, Andrew Leakey. But if your footwear is not suitable, then it doesn't matter how well equipped the rest of your outfit may be. The rest of your armor is useless if you don't have shoes, because without them, you can't get involved in the battle. You would be taken out by the first stone that you stepped upon. So when Paul talks about shoes, he's referring to the shoes that the Roman soldiers wore, called caligas or half boots. They were made of leather, open-toed with a heavy studded sole. And they were tied to the ankles and shins with straps. They were perfect for both long marches and for a solid stance. They were mobile, but also provided grip so that his foot would not slip, so he could stand firm, that he could stand solid. Now, one of my hobbies is running, so a quick shout out to any big and runways out there. And I wear different types of trainers for different types of runs I go on. So these trainers, my beautiful assistant here, come say hi, Ollie.
Hi.
These trainers are my road running trainers, and they're perfect for running on pavements and running on roads. They're light and they've got very little grip on the bottom. However, if I was to take these off-road, if I was to take them onto a trail, then they would quickly fail me. I would lose grip and I'd slide away. So I've got these trainers coming in that haven't been washed since the last time I used them. Well, these are my trail running trainers, or they're perfect for muddy terrain. They've got quick, they allow liquid out of them quickly, but they've got these great studs on the bottom which give me brilliant grip, not only to stand firm but to progress through muddy terrain. I also used to love playing rugby, and rugby boots are really quite different to 10-pin bowling shoes, because they need to be able to provide the players with a solid stance to absorb and even advance against the opposition. They've got long studs and even more ankle support. See, the shoes we wear are so important. Paul highlights the shoes as part of the armour of God as we look at this passage, and you'll see that on four occasions, his encouragement is to stand firm grounded, sure-footed. Because what a great encouragement to stand, because wobbly Christians without a firm foothold in Christ are easily knocked over. Sadly, many of us will know people who are Christians who, in the face of the hardest trials life has thrown at them, their faith has remained solid. Even now, I'm sure you can bring to mind people who've inspired you by their faith in God. I think of mothers and fathers who've lost children, or friends who've had to and continue to battle with degenerative or terminal illnesses. Family members who, through no fault of their own, have been on the receiving end of injustice, and yet their faith remains strong. Their footing remains firm. They do not slip because their foundations are secure. They know their God and they have the gospel on their feet. Sadly, we probably can also bring to mind those whom feet has slipped. In times of trouble, when storms of life or the schemes of the enemy have come, they've been knocked off their feet. And maybe that's even true for you today. Maybe you know what it's like to be full of faith and gradually know that you've lost your strong stance and you've slipped. See, Jesus tells a parable of the wise and foolish builders. One builds their house on sand, the other builds their house on rock. And you don't need a degree in construction to know which of the houses is going to survive the storm. Jesus could just as easily have been telling a parable about a man who wore 10-pin bowling shoes and the man who wore rugby boots to climb a steep and muddy hill. See, the good news for us is that Jesus' armoury is still open. The kingdom of God is in the relocation business. Where you've been building on sand, Jesus can pick that up and sit you on the rock. Where you know you've been wearing the wrong shoes, we can go towards him, and even now, and we can get kitted up. choosing by faith to put on the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness, buckle up the belt of truth and hold up the sword of the Spirit and have the shield of faith and the shoes of the gospel. But is it just to stand? I think we can actually apply this encouragement in two different ways. The word readiness can mean preparation or firmness. So the gospel provides for those of us who believe in it a firmness to stand, a firm footing, preventing us from slipping. But we could also look at the word readiness as preparation, prepared to share this gospel of peace. Paul says to the Colossians to make the most of every opportunity. And Isaiah 52 verse 7 says how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation. So I think it's a classic both and. Putting on the shoes of the readiness given by the gospel of peace means that we can stand in the face of adversity. We can stand. When the storm rages and rages around us, we can stand. When all about us seems to be slipping away, we can stand on the good news of Jesus. Stand on the rock that is our salvation. But just as Peter encourages us in 1 Peter 3, we should also be ready to give an account of what we believe. In this standing, we must also be ready to respond as Holy Spirit leads us to be ready to proclaim this wonderful gospel of peace. Lest we forget that the very reason we need armour is because there is an enemy. Armour's not needed in times of peace, it's needed in war times. And believer, we are at war. There's an enemy who'd like nothing more than to see your feet slip and the advance of the gospel to be hindered. So be well equipped. In these verses, Paul uses Greek present and passive imperatives, which means basically in verses 10 and 11, it means that the word Paul uses is an ongoing thing, not just a one-off event, that we should keep on being made strong in the Lord. And that we should keep on being clothed with the full armour of God. Jesus is the one who clothes us in this armour through the gospel, but we need to be going to his armoury every day. Jesus has made us right before God. He's dealt with everything which separates us from him. He's justified us so we can sit. But he's at work in us still, shaping us through the Holy Spirit, leading us so that we can walk. And he arms us with the solid shoes of the gospel so that we can also stand. And Fee's going to come and pray for us before we enter into a time of worship. Come on, babe.
Good morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that your love is unconditional. Lord, would you help us put into practice what we have heard this morning? Father, help us model the kingdom of God in our lives as we put on the gospel of peace, remaining firm in times of trouble and difficulty. Lord Jesus, I ask that we be prepared and ready to respond to the Holy Spirit, to share your gospel to those who don't yet know you. Father, let your kingdom come and your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Be glorified in us and through us this morning as we worship together. Amen. Mm-hmm. We're now going to hand over to Gareth and the worship group who are going to lead us in worship.
There is Psalm 96, a call to worship God in the splendour of his glory and holiness.
Sing a new song to the Lord. Sing to the Lord, all the world.
Sing to the Lord and praise him. Proclaim every day the good news that he has saved us.
Proclaim his glory to the nations, his mighty deeds to all peoples.
The Lord is great and is to be highly praised. He is to be honoured more than all the gods.
The gods of all other nations are only idols, but the Lord created the heavens.
Glory and majesty surround him. Power and beauty fill his temple.
Praise the Lord, all people on earth.
Praise his glory and might.
Praise the Lord's glorious name. Bring an offering and come to his temple.
Bow before the Holy One, in garments of worship. Tremble before him, all the earth.
Say to all the nations, the Lord is King.
The earth is set firmly in place and cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with justice.
Be glad, earth and sky. Roar, sea and every creature in you. Be glad, fields and everything in you.
The trees in the woods will shout for joy when the Lord comes to rule the earth.
He will rule the peoples of the world with justice and fairness.
Amen. Let's worship him this morning.
It's been a stressful morning to try and get all this set up, but I'm hoping that you're hearing us loud and clear and everything is working. I really want to encourage you, if you can, to stand up and to really just rejoice. It's John and Ali, thank you so much for leading us in that song of worship and praise. Let's carry on, let's worship, let's give God every praise. Hallelujah. Come on, let's sing. Let's stand and sing. That you bring into our lives. We want to bring all our praises to you. We thank you, Lord, no one is like you. Lord, no one can separate us from your love. We thank you, Lord, whatever happens in our lives, that we know you're sovereign and, Lord, you're utterly in control. We thank you for this gospel, Lord, that we stand very firmly upon. We thank you, Lord, for peace with God through Christ Jesus. And, Lord, we pray, help us to really to come and to just bring ourselves to you, Lord, although we're so separated, Lord, and it feels like it more and more as time goes on. Lord, we pray, God, would you draw close to us individually? We pray for every person, Lord, just on their own at home right now, God, that you'll draw close to them. We thank you, Lord, that is your hand upon us. We thank you for grace in time of need. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I have my band with me, hopefully. Gone wonky now. I'm going to put it right. Hallelujah. Well, great. There's a couple of things that we just haven't done for 5 weeks now. We haven't taken an offering. And it's part of our worship to God. And if you think, oh, we haven't done an offering, if you go to the website, there's bank details there. If you want to make a bank transfer, that'd be great. We still have costs of still running a church, staff costs and so on, although we've not got the building costs in quite the same way. Although we are using the building, as you know, for the community, which is great. So that's another thing just before. We have one more song of worship, which is a compilation song where various people have kind of done it over the internet. It's great. And thank you for those who've contributed in that way. Just to say, at 7 o'clock tonight, Ray is going to be ministering to us on our Sunday evening. That's going to be on the members' page, the kind of the closed page. If you want to join that page, you need to send an email link, and we'll look at that for you. Thank you. And so God bless you. We're going to come back after this song just to kind of stay online so people can make comments and stuff like that at the end. So we're not going to just stop the transmission. Anyway, enjoy worshiping Jesus again with this song.
Hold you, the veil tall before you. You
Together, this is what Paul wrote to the Corinthians right at the end. He said this: may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And